Hello, neighbor. This is Pastor Jimmy, proclaiming the truth with words of encouragement. Greetings in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible is the Word of God. God's still on the throne. Jesus is alive and coming to solve all of our problems that come today. Today, we're going to talk on a subject called visions. Visions. I want to read some scripture to you. So if you have your Bibles, turn to Proverbs chapter number 19, verse number 18. And the Bible says this, "Where there is no vision, the people perish. But he that keepeth the law, happy is he." Proverbs 19, 18. Then it says in Joel 2:28, "And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions." What is a vision? What is a vision? There are four questions I want to ask you this morning. What is a vision? Number one. Where do visions come from? Number two. Why do we need visions? And what do we do when God gives us a vision? Well, the Bible says this about visions. Or actually, Webster says this about a vision. It's unusual foresight. Notice not eyesight, but foresight. It's a mental image produced by imagination. That's what Webster says. Visions requires three things. The ability to see, that's awareness. The faith to believe, that's attitude. The courage to do, that's action. So what is a vision? Well, it's unusual foresight. Notice I said not eyesight. A vision for the ministry is a reflection of what God wants to accomplish through you to build his kingdom. Remember this, what he said in Joel, young men shall have visions, old men shall have dreams. In the visions in the Old Testament were prophetic visions. Daniel had them, he prophesied. Isaiah had them, he prophesied the future. And in the New Testament, Peter had them, and so did the Apostle Paul. So what is a vision? Webster said, it's unusual foresight. But God gives us a vision far greater than that. Where do visions come from is the next question. Visions come from God. He has a purpose. Visions come from God because God gives us a purpose to do something. God gives visions to guide and direct us. Now, there's a lot of people out there, foolish teaching, foolish preaching about visions, and I've seen this and I've seen that. But listen to me. God gives us a vision to guide us and to direct us. To guide us and direct us. God reveals his will and plan by visions. As a matter of fact, Dr. Clemens had a vision about starting this TV ministry. And he tossed and turned with it for quite a while. And then he started doing what God wanted him to do. And now guess what, ladies and gentlemen? We have Christian World TV. That is wonderful that God gave him that vision. And he started doing what God told him to do. And things are working out well. The TV program is going out all over the world. God gives vision to guide and direct us. And that's what God did with Brother Mack. He was guiding and directing him to start this TV program. God opens eyes and hearts and minds by his visions. So what do we get? Where do visions come from? They come from God. Why do we need a vision is the third thing. First I said, what is a vision? And then I said, where do visions come from? Now, why do we need visions? God gives us vision to show our true potential. God gives us visions, and it takes us to a new level. John 4:35 says, "Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes and look at the fields where they are already white as white for harvest. What Jesus is saying in John 45 is, look at the condition of the world. It is ready for harvest. Lady, neighbor, if you look around, look at the turmoil, look at the killing, look at the murder, look at the rape. In the United States, we send missionaries all over the world in our churches today. But do you know there's a great mission field here in the United States? Right here in the United States, there's a mission field. There's young people that need to be led to the Lord. I told on the last program about Dr. Ron Riley going to Daytona Beach. This year will be 55 years. He's been taking young people to Daytona, and they've been winning so over 100 and something thousand people led to the Lord. Guess what? God gave him a vision to go to Daytona 54 years ago. So listen to me. The fields are there, and they're wide and ready for harvest. Look around at America. Everywhere you go, there's an opportunity to tell somebody about Jesus. Just grasp that vision. What Jesus is saying in John 4:35, look at the condition. If you and I look at the condition of the world, you'll see through the eyes that God has given you, spiritual eyes, you'll see that we need to be winning souls here. We need to be teaching people here about the things of the Lord. Now, I don't want you to take me wrong about the statement I'm fixing to make. Football stadiums are full with hundreds and thousands of people. Matter of fact, I love football. I was watching an Alabama game here several months ago, and they had over 100,000 people attend one of those football games. Nothing wrong with it, but wouldn't it be nice if you had 100,000 in a church one day? Our 50,000, wouldn't it be nice if our church, can you visualize your church being full and the preacher get up and preach and people weep? Years ago, ladies and gentlemen, there was preaching and people would weep and come to the altar. Well, neighbor, look at this. What do we need? What do we do when God gives us a vision? That's a great question. What do we do when God gives us a vision? Vision, number one, requires action. There's a lot of talking today, but there's not a lot of action. There's a lot of preaching on TV is give me this and give me that. Sometimes I feel guilty about telling people about my books because there's so many people out there begging for money all the time. So we got to be careful what we do. But visions require action. So when God speaks to your heart and gives you a vision, you need to do something. God does not guide us where he will not provide for us. If God wants you to do something, he'll provide for you. I was telling an evangelist friend of mine, his name is Dr. John Mitchell. Great evangelist. I had him in my church back in the 80s. And he goes all over America preaching. I was telling him today about visions and talking about the things of God and the old times that we used to have. People would come to the altar and weep and cry. But you see, we don't see that today. And neighbor, we need to see people that have a broken heart to get their heart right and do the things of the Lord. And Dr. Mitchell is going all over. He said it ain't like what it used to be. I'll tell you why it is. Not because people's got a cold heart. Their hearts are cold. And so we need a vision today. We need to visualize it. There's people out there that need the Lord Jesus Christ, and it's our job to tell them how to be saved. Matter of fact, Evangelist Pat Tower will be preaching probably today, and he's going to be telling you about soul winning. He's been preaching on soul winning for months now. A great preacher, great soul winner. God's power has no limit. When God gives us a vision, his power has no limit. Matter of fact, he's got all the power anyway. But he gives us power to live the Christian life. He gives us power to become victorious. Listen, God saved us not to just live a life. God saved us to live an abundant life. And that abundant life comes through the power of the Lord Jesus Christ and our submission to Him. God's power has, God's vision needs to be great. Be great. Think about it. You say, well, I can't do this. I heard somebody say that. I can't do this. And I can't. You can do all things through Christ Jesus. All things through Christ Jesus. You can do all things through Christ Jesus. We need to act on faith when God gives us a vision. James 2, 17 through 20 tells us that faith without works is dead. You can talk all day about it, but if you don't do anything, it's dead works. James is saying if your vision is fulfilled, then you must work. Talking about it won't get it done. Trust in God and start doing it. Somebody says, Pastor Jimmy, how do I know the will of God in my life? Well, you just start doing the things that God's told you to do. There's things in the Bible He tells us to do. He tells us to go out and teach, and He tells us to go out and bring people to the Lord, that His house might be fulfilled. Just going out. But people don't want to go out today, and they don't want to knock on doors, and they don't want to invite people to church. So therefore, ladies and gentlemen, we can't get our vision done, we can't get our work done, if we just talk about it. Talking about it won't get it done. Trust God and He'll get it done for you. Wow. Visions. You know, thinking about visions, two of my favorite women had a vision. I love to study about these ladies. One of them is Helen Keller. Helen Keller was a woman with a vision, even though she was blind. People say, I can't do this. She was blind, and God gave her vision. She was born in Tuscoma, Alabama, on June 27, 1880. She died on June the 1st, 1968. She, as a child, contacted a disease that damaged her brain and her eyes. That didn't stop her from her vision. She overcame adversity of being blind and deaf. She became an author, an activist, and a lecturer. This is a woman that was blind and deaf. She was the first blind person to earn a Bachelor of Arts degree. In 1964, President L.B. Johnson awarded her with a Presidential Medal of Freedom, one of the highest U.S. civil honors there is. Helen Keller, in 1965, was elected to the National Women's Hall of Fame at New York World Affair. In 1999, Helen Keller, now I'm talking about a person with a vision. You say, I can't do this, I can't do that. You need to see the miracle worker, where this young lady teaches her how to talk down the road. Helen Keller's hospital is in Sheffield, Alabama. It's dedicated to her. There are streets named after her in Spain, Israel, Portugal, and France. Now look at this. Here's a woman with a vision that was blind. There's a statue of her as a child standing at a water pump. The first word that she understood was water. She learned how to say water. And so therefore, she was a woman with a vision. She was once asked, what is worse than being blind? And here's what she replied. She said, having sight with no vision. Helen Keller was a woman with vision. Wow, even though she was blind. Number two, and we'll be closing in a moment. Not only was Helen Keller a woman with a vision, Fanny Crosby. Oh, I love to talk and study about Fanny Crosby. Fanny Crosby was a woman with a vision, even though she was blind. She was born March 24th, 1820 in Brewster, New York. She died February 12, 1918. She was 95 years old when she died. She was an American mission worker, poet, lyricist, and composer of long life Methodist. Born with normal vision at birth, but was at age six suffered eye inflammation due to an unqualified doctor who put a solution on her eyes and left her eyes scarred. Refusing to let her handicap limit her, she asked God to use her, and He did. She began to write poems. Her first poem, listen to this, O happy day, soul I am, although I cannot see, I'm resolved that in this world contented I will be. How many blessings I enjoy that other people don't know. To weep and sigh because I'm blind, I cannot and I won't. In 1935, at the age 14, Fanny Crosby, listen to this, was enrolled in New York Institute for the Blind. She was so talented in poetry, she became a teacher. Now, listen to me. Here's a blind person like Helen Keller, and she became a teacher in that institute in 1842. She married at the age 37 and remained married until her husband died in 1902. There was no children, but died. There was a child, but the child died right after birth. One of her longtime friends, listen to this, was President Grover Cleveland. She met a part-time composer named William Doane, and they became friends and were friends for more than 40 years. He asked Fanny to write a poem using the phrase, "Pass me not, O gentle Savior." One of my favorite songs is "Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior." Sometimes I play that when we give the invitation for people to come and be saved. While speaking at a prison, one of the inmates called, "Good Lord, don't pass me by." That was just what she needed. "Pass me not, O gentle Savior." She met Ira Sankey and Billy D.L. Moody. They became friends, and Sankey used and published many of her hymns. Fanny Crosby had a vision. She had spiritual insight without having physical eyesight. She was the author. Now listen to this. Her vision. Remember, she's blind. She was the author of more than 8,000 hymns and also wrote many poems. Today, many of her hymns continue to comfort and draw souls to the Lord, to the great evangelist, due to the great evangelist D.L. Moody and singer Ira Sankey. Her first few was this. Listen to this. A woman with a vision that was blind. "Pass me not, O gentle Savior. Blessed assurance." We have this song because a lady had a vision. "To God be the glory. All the way my Savior leads. Safe in the arms of Jesus. Rescue the perishing. Jesus, keep me near the cross. I am thine, O Lord." Neighbor, don't let anything stop you if God gives you a vision. She was active in speaking engagements and missionary work until her death in 1915. She was 95 years old when she died. What happened when Fanny died? Listen to this. Perhaps one of her hymns tells it best. "When my life work is ended and I cross the swelling tide, when the bright and glorious morning I shall see, I shall know my Redeemer when I reach the other side, and his smile will be the first to welcome me. I shall know him, I shall know him, and redeemed by his side I shall stand. I shall know him, I shall know him, by the print of the nails in his hand." The lives of these two great women should inspire you to get a vision. Well, neighbor, until next time, I say, find you a good Bible preaching church. Get into that church. Get active. Get into serving the Lord. And listen to this. May your troubles be less. May your blessings be more. And may nothing but happiness come your way. And don't forget to tell somebody about Jesus. Please tell somebody about Jesus. Until then, may God bless you. I'll see you here, there, or in there. Get a vision today. Get a vision today and do something for the Lord. God bless you until next time.